In 1934, production began on the SFH-18, a 15-centimeter howitzer that was built by Rheinmetall GmbH and mounted on a carriage built by the famous weapons manufacturer, Krupp. This was to become the backbone of the Wehrmacht's medium artillery. No records exist of the actual numbers produced, but it would have been substantial, since the SFH-18 remained in service throughout the entire war, and many were delivered to Finland and Italy for their use. Despite using 8 different charges, the maximum range of the SFH-18 was only 13,325 meters, and early combat experience revealed that the opposition, especially after 1941, often outranged it when German artillery encountered the formidable Soviet 152mm guns and howitzers. Although contracts were awarded to develop new designs, and a 17cm version was introduced later in the war, the pace of events was such that the SFH-18 was never replaced. Airborne units, mountain troops, and special army formations were a special problem for German weapon designers. These units needed artillery, but did not have the means to transport the heavy pieces. They needed a range of efficient, lightweight artillery, which could be carried on pack animals, or quickly rushed in by air where necessary. Decreasing the weight of a conventional artillery piece is usually achieved by the use of light alloys in the barrel and carriage construction. But these were in short supply in Germany throughout the war. In a conventional gun, the energy released when a propellant charge is exploded not only drives the projectile from the barrel, but also forces the barrel to the rear, where it is slowed by the carriage recoil mechanism. As the forces involved in firing a gun are considerable, the recoil mechanism has to be sturdy, and therefore very heavy. The recoilless gun was the solution to the problem. The exhaust gases were allowed to escape through a nozzle placed to the rear of a breech, providing the equal or appropriate force to the blast, which stopped the gun from recoiling. The first service version of a recoilless gun was the Krupp LG-11, which entered limited service with the Luftwaffe paratroops during 1940. They were first used in action during the airborne assault on Crete. As a first attempt, the LG-1.300 had its shortcomings, one of which was that the carriage weight had been reduced to the point where it proved to be too flimsy for the rigorous demands of active service. The replacement design, the 7.5cm LG-40, was a much more robust weapon, with a revised breech and small all-metal wheels. The LG-40 embodied most of the features of the later German recoilless guns. In 1943, it was decided that a larger gun was required, and the 10.5cm was put into service. In the airborne role, the 7.5 and 10.5cm guns could be landed in several ways. One was to drop them in several separate loads in containers suspended from parachutes. Practiced crews could then assemble the guns and bring them into action in about 2 minutes. Another method was to suspend the guns in tubular steel frames under transport aircraft, which could then land with them or drop them using large parachutes. A further alternative was to load the gun together with its light tractor in a Gotha GO-242 glider. If an aircraft was available, considerable loads could be flown in by the 6-engined Messerschmitt Gigant, although as we can see from this sequence shot in Russia during 1943, despite the huge size of the aircraft, loading was never easy. Numbers of recoilless guns were also issued to mountain troops, but very often Their dangerous exhaust characteristics restricted their use, so specialised conventional guns were developed.
In mountainous terrain, there were a number of factors which influenced the type of guns you could use. The troops would always be in need of artillery support, and it posed some very special problems. In order, obviously, to be able to get a gun up a mountain, you couldn't take vehicles up there, so the guns had to be capable of being broken down into small loads, which could then be carried by mules. And they were actually officially described as being a 4-mule load or an 8-mule load or however many were necessary. One of the other things you didn't want in mountain warfare was a gun which recoiled, because if it recoiled backwards too far, who's to say it wasn't going to keep going in over the side of a cliff or something like that?
In one form or another, the rocket has been a weapon of war for many centuries. Among the larger rockets used by the Germans were 15, 28, and 32 centimeter missiles. The 15 centimeter rocket was the most common and was intended for service in batteries. Its tactical role was the saturation of large target areas with high explosives, smoke, or poison gas. It was designated the 15 centimeter Werfgranate 41 and was first issued during late 1940. The spin-stabilised 15-centimetre WGR-41 was produced with a range of fillings. As the rocket motors were affected by extremes in temperature, special versions were issued to cope with the tropical encounters of the Afrika Corps. Yet another special variant had to be produced to deal with the opposite extremes of cold encountered on the Russian front. The main projector used to launch the missiles in Russia was the 15-centimeter WGR-41. But fired by the specially formed Nebeltruppen, or fog troops, was the 15-centimeter Nebelwerfer 41.
Nebelwerfer means, essentially, smoke thrower, and it had been designed as a weapon which could lay down a very thick smoke screen very quickly. In fact, the Germans realised that this six-barrelled rocket launcher could deliver a very heavy bombardment of high explosive projectiles as well as a very heavy smoke bombardment. And thus the Nebelwerfer, when it first came into use in 1942, it was used as an artillery piece that could lay down its six rocket projectiles over a very concentrated area. The British described the Nebelwerfer as the moaning mini, and grew to hate a Nebelwerfer stonk, as they called it, as it could be very devastating.
The Nebelwerfer was produced in all different versions. There was a single-barreled version for paratroops. There was a 10-barreled version that went about in an armored tracked carrier. And there was a giant 30-centimeter Nebelwerfer that fired a rocket. There was a 10-barreled 150-millimeter Nebelwerfer. Lots of these were designed to fire an artillery projectile without the encumbrance of having a gun. The Nebelwerfer was much smaller and fired much more rapidly than a gun because it was so simple. It wasn't always very accurate, could never be as accurate as an artillery piece, but it was very simple and easy to operate. There were, in fact, Nebelwerfers that were designed to take the rounds and fire them directly from their packing cases without even having to take them out of the box and set them up. Not an accurate way to fire a rocket, but very rapid and very convenient.